Dreams could not be any scarier than the freakish creations of Hieronymus Bosch. His eerie visions display disturbed imagery that was unmatched at the end of the Middle Ages. When we see his art, it portrays personal battles within a troubled mind that inspired painted lessons for humankind. There is no mistaking the unique creations of Hieronymus Bosch for works by contemporaries like Leonardo da Vinci or Raphael. Many of his paintings are a feast of fantasy visions we have never witnessed before, which is quite startling considering the conventions of this period. His odd creations keep us asking where these disturbing yet extraordinary characters came from. Hello everyone, my name is Craig, host of Medieval to Modern. We feature fascinating information from civilization's medieval ages. After presenting another captivating episode of history, we will reveal the Medieval to Modern top 8 of intriguing facts about Hieronymus Bosch. Thank you for joining us today. Hieronymus Bosch is the most enigmatic Dutch master painter we know. There are no known diaries or notes that he left behind. The artist's birth name was Jeroen van Aken. He was born around the year 1450 in the present-day Dutch town of Hertogenbosch to a family of painters. He too entered the profession, though we have no records of how he came about his unique style of painting. Mr. Bosch surely felt as devoted to his hometown as he was to his Christian beliefs, since he spent his entire career in this place. When most people think about the paintings of Hieronymus Bosch, they are particularly interested with the middle years of his outstanding career. During that period, Mr. Bosch produced the masterpiece for which he is most celebrated, The Garden of Earthly Delights. This famous creation was estimated to have been made between 1490 to 1510. There have been numerous detailed descriptions of this one-of-a-kind painting written over the centuries. Though what is the source of Hieronymus Bosch's haunting depictions? The Garden of Earthly Delights is a triptych oil painting on a surface of three oak panels. When opened and looking left to right, we see the first panel. Its biblical scene is referred to as the joining of Adam and Eve, or paradise in the Garden of Eden. It is the middle panel by which the triptych is known, the Garden of Earthly Delights. Here we see a wide assortment of humankind behavior, free of any moral restrictions. Included in the middle scene are naked frolicking and engagement in various biblical sins. The right panel, referred to as hell, is a carnival of torture and punishment by demon-like figures. There are images of horrible imprisonment, along with numerous grotesque mutilations and painful retributions for sin. When the side panels are closed, another image painted in grisaille is revealed. It is referred to as creation of the world. Keeping with this artist's strong faith, it reveals God's shaping of earth after 3 days. Looking further into this painting, we note underlying themes of sin, fear, death, and punishment are continuously explored. In the Garden of Earthly Delights, one notes that Hieronymus Bosch is not an optimistic judge of human character. He is a keen observer of society's obsession with lust and physical pleasure, and seems to compel us to take heed of the harm from such vices. These distorted, eerie images are not meant to create a sense of trust in the nature of humankind. Clearly, he is portraying a society swayed by vices. It is a world that is utterly corrupt and lacking in the basics of trust and moral values. So, where do these freakish creatures, unnatural beings, and contorted figures have their origins? Their detailed, almost futuristic depictions are stunning, as if viewed firsthand by the artist's own eyes before being transferred to these oak panels. Having made our descriptive introduction to the Garden of Earthly Delights, we shall now attempt to answer where the mind of Hieronymus Bosch accessed these disturbing visions. As with many fears we have later in life, it is often said childhood events could hold important clues. Hieronymus Bosch is no exception if we look at what happened to his hometown during the year 1463. It was at this time his beloved town experienced a major fire which destroyed 4,000 homes. There is nothing like towering flames causing massive destruction of familiar places to lose your sense of security. This major fire could have led to a mistrust of security in society and surroundings which he carried from this traumatizing event into his paintings. Continuing a focus on his early life leads to a second possible source for the grotesque creatures of Hieronymus Bosch. In the Middle Ages, bread was a daily staple for most households. In his town, rye bread would have been a common variety. Ergotism is a form of poisoning from ingesting alkaloids present in grains, especially rye, that had been infected by the Claviceps purpurea fungus. This ailment was common in medieval Netherlands and known as St. Anthony's Fire. We know Hieronymus Bosch depicted this saint over 20 times in his paintings. Could ergot poisoning have produced the wild hallucinations which powered his surreal creations? His macabre, vivid depictions and warped images painted with energetic brushstrokes suggest a mind heavy with tortures of the mind. Vivid hallucinations dealing with fire are common with ergot poisoning. The Temptation of Saint Anthony, another of his famous triptychs, shows a city on fire, a sign of the protection granted by Saint Anthony against ergotism. The one wonders how the artist could have made these detailed paintings while in the throes of such a painful, disfiguring disease. In my view, it is more reasonable to assume Mr. Bosch was the observer of fellow townspeople dealing with this horrific disease and not a victim himself while painting. These muses would provide the grounding for his graphic depictions of contorted agony and dismemberments. Some regions of medieval Europe thought the signs of ergotism were initial steps towards hellfire. In Mr. Bosch's paintings, which rely to a great degree on symbolism, we see a surreal vision on the whole concept of religion and the human place within it. I believe Mr. Bosch's focused, otherworldly imagery is meant to capture our attention to the pending danger of mortal sins. For in his portrayals of nightmarish hell, serious sinners endure a future of continuous punishment. There is another possible source for Hieronymus Bosch's stark imagery. These fanciful creations could have been the product of a lifetime studying early Christian Bible books and manuscripts. When one looks at such material from the medieval ages, they contain numerous illustrations and figures which deviate from natural depictions. Their frightening interpretations of heaven, hell, and purgatory were meant to have its reader frightened into faith and devotion. When combined with deep-set traditions of folklore at that time, it was almost certain these elements were also used in Hieronymus Bosch's works. Fear was a constant in the everyday world surrounding Hieronymus Bosch. A growing societal transformation from the medieval period to the Renaissance happened during his lifetime. As a result, there seemed a great anxiety within the artist, an uncertainty with beliefs once held dear by society and himself. Let us not forget the infamous witch hunts began during the 14th and 15th centuries. To my mind, his paintings show a deep concern with salvation, morality, and the afterlife, consistent with important issues in his dominant church culture society. During the late medieval period, beliefs that marked the high point of the Middle Ages were being challenged by new thoughts and experimentation. This included questioning the rigid authority of religious organizations and their strict hierarchy. However, centuries of devotion were still a large part of the everyday. Growing societal and political chaos also created a desire for familiar ways and many frightened by the future unknown. The consequences of an uncertain world may have manifested in Mr. Bosch's work with surreal spiritual battles between earthly temptation and the need for salvation. Of course, the depictions in Mr. Bosch's paintings were not all apocalyptic. There is also amusement in these odd figures and gestures. In my opinion, Hieronymus Bosch used freakish, horrific creatures and bizarre imagery to attract our attention to the vices he felt compelled to warn us against. Unfortunately, very little personal information is available on Hieronymus Bosch to confirm or deny these theories. Millions of people over centuries have gazed upon the Garden of Earthly Delights in both shock and wonder. They too ask themselves how these images of freakish creatures and sin came into the mind of Hieronymus Bosch. His use of brilliant technique and dark symbolism stays with our minds. It is a shame that we can only view the works of Hieronymus Bosch in 25 authorized paintings. This Dutch master artist, seen as the early pioneer of surrealism, has also influenced modern era paintings from artists like Max Ernst and Salvador Dali. Hieronymus Bosch passed away on August 9, 1516. At the time of his death, he was internationally recognized and collected by noble families in Spain, the Netherlands, and Austria. Which brings us to that time at which we will share the Medieval to Modern Top 8 of intriguing facts about Hieronymus Bosch. As our viewers know, we believe knowledge is ageless as well as enjoyable. Now, we shall present them all for your learning pleasure. Number 1. Hieronymus Bosch is known to have signed only 7 of his works. Number 2. Hieronymus Bosch did not date his paintings. Number 3. 8 drawings have also been confidently authorized as made by this artist. Number 4. The Garden of Earthly Delights is now housed at the Museo del Prado in Madrid, its home since 1939. Number 5. Unfortunately, some of his works may have fallen victim to the societal values of the Protestant Reformation, which destroyed paintings viewed as immoral. Number 6. Yes, even his adopted painting name of Hieronymus Bosch was derived from his birthplace. Number 7. Between the year 1479 to 1481, Mr. Bosch married a wealthy woman, which meant he did not have to rely solely on painting for his livelihood. Number 8. It is widely assumed that Bosch's father or one of his uncles taught him to paint, but none of their works are in existence today. Thank you for supporting us at Medieval to Modern. Please be sure to watch our next episode or one shown at the end of this video. Also be sure to like, subscribe, comment, and spread the word about this channel so we can create more exciting content. I wish you good tidings as we remember that sharing knowledge has been a noble deed throughout the ages.